So the Wrath of Sparta has been out a few days, and it seems that a lot of you have picked it up. Just something I want to get into before we start the review, that out of around the 200 friends I have that have Rome 2, over 70 of you have already purchased this DLC. Now I know my skew of friends are going to be among the hardcore fans of Rome 2, but even this is a massive number and really surprised me that so many of you purchased this DLC on day of release. We can definitely see why the prices are the way they are, and why there is so much DLC for Rome 2. It's clearly working. Something else I noticed was that only 44% of the Steam reviews are positive, giving this DLC the lowest rating of all Rome 2's DLCs. For all of you messaging me saying they regret their purchase, I told you time and time again, always wait for my review or the reviews of people you can trust, be it friends or online. I didn't receive this early, so I played it at the same time as everybody else, and usually when a reviewer doesn't get sent a review copy of something ahead of time, it's usually a bad sign, though CA do rotate their YouTuber friends a bit when it comes to this stuff, so it might just be that. So without further delay, let's find out all there is to know about Wrath of Sparta and what I think of it. As always, no mods or graphical enhancements are running or have been edited into this video. What you see is what you get. So Wrath of Sparta focuses on the Peloponnesian War set in 431 BC. For those who don't know, this was an ancient Greek war fought by the Athenian Empire against the Peloponnesian League led by Sparta. Every nation in Greece chose a side, and the war lasted nearly 30 years, with both land and sea battles fought throughout the Aegean and in Sicily. Sparta were known for having excellent quality troops on land, and Athens for having a superior navy, which made for a very interesting power play between the two, never wishing to play to the other's strengths, instead opting for allies that could help them in their rivals' theatre. It also gave rise to famous commanders and orators such as Pericles, Nicias, Brasidas, and Lysander. The campaign itself, however, focuses on the Aegean only, which is a pretty large disappointment for many, but is where 90% of the combat was focused. You can play as four factions, the Athenae, Boeotian League, Corinthos, and Sparta. Each of these factions can also have a civil war and have their civil war counterparts. Sparta, Corinthos, and Boeotian League all start as military allies at war with Athens, so Athens definitely has the hardest time of all factions, I feel. They do have a lot of allies also, but their capital is surrounded from the get-go. That said, there is a new feature in Wrath of Sparta that incurs a large diplomatic penalty for capturing any of the four capitals, the reason for which is to mirror the fact that when these nations went to war, they rarely captured any of their capitals, instead eating away at their overseas holdings, and to also prevent people just going like crazy at the start, expanding too easily. Really, this just keeps the player from doing it, but the AI have no problem expanding, which is kind of frustrating to watch your allies capture the prize that you had your eye on. Something that should be pointed out straight away is that each of these new factions are for the campaign only. Athenae, Sparta, Corinthos, and Boeotian League are only playable in the Wrath of Sparta campaign. You cannot check the rosters or play with them in multiplayer battles unless, of course, you play the campaign with somebody else who owns Wrath of Sparta. This is a huge disappointment. The first thing I went to do was check the rosters of Corinth and Boeotian League, as I thought I'd have two new multiplayer factions to play with. This, no doubt, is a large reason for the subpar reviews, as it instantly devalues the campaign pack compared to previous ones. It is understandable that such early era troops don't feature in multiplayer, and that adding more units on top of the already DLC Athens and Sparta might be muddled and messy, but to complete Epirus's roster you need the Greek states and the Beasts of War, so it's not like it hasn't been done before. Really disappointed and downright surprised at this situation, and I really would hope with that enough outcry, perhaps CA would consider unlocking them for multiplayer. I don't see why not, they'll probably be underpowered and it'd be fun to play just early Greek battles. Moving on to what you do get. Each faction has a pretty tame roster in the campaign, with about 13 units per faction, including the naval units. Corinthos and Athenae have the exact same roster, and the Boeotian League have the exact same roster plus one extra unit. I'll just list them in case they are of interest, and then list Sparta's, which is a little bit different. First, we have three types of missile units: archers, javelin men, and slingers. Pretty standard, same as the base game really. Next, we have four types of spear unit, working their way up in tier from militia hoplites, to light hoplites, to hoplites, and finally, picked hoplites. Then for cavalry, there is two units, light cavalry and hippeus, and the Boeotians' extra unit is the Theban hippeus, which are slightly better than the hippeus. Lastly, for naval, we have archer marines, javelin marines, marines, and armored marines, each of which are classed as melee. Before we get to Sparta, you'll notice that each faction has no shock cavalry, no sword units, no artillery, and very few units in general, meaning you'll be fielding the same armies constantly and fighting the same ones too. More on that later. Sparta are somewhat more diverse, fielding the same missile units and cavalry, but more land spear units in exchange for less naval units. Their Skirtai unit are an excellent mid-tier spear unit that throw javelins, which make them the only unit in the DLC and in the campaign to do so, giving them a huge edge. Their Royal Spartans are second to none in terms of quality also. So that's what you'll be playing with, four factions and a combined total of 21 unique units to play with. In terms of playing against, Well, if Thrake, or the Adrisian Kingdom, survive past turn 5, then you'll see some barbarian influences, and later in the game you should see the arrival of Persia with a roster of eastern units with some brand new ones such as the Immortal Spearmen, the Phrygian Spearmen, and Sakai Horse Archers, which are a real pain to deal with when you have nothing to combat them, really. So with 15 factions sharing mainland Greece that all have the exact same roster, bar Sparta, your enemies are fairly numerous and fairly dull. It is to be expected, fighting Greeks all the time, but some variation to them would have been nice. Historically, they all had their own personalities, and you never quite get that feeling here. When the Persians arrive, or if they arrive, as my first playthrough they just didn't, your armies feel superior to their low-class eastern armies that are just more numerous, but lack any quality, so the battles are just more frustrating than challenging. Moving on, let's talk about some of the changes to the campaign. I played mostly as Corinthos, who start out spread across the Aegean, which does make for some interesting gameplay, trying to unify your holdings and establish trade routes. Athenae are similar, starting fairly disjointed and spread out, which is a nice change from the regular campaigns where you start as a block and expand outward. Nothing special, just a nice change. Some of the new features for Wrath of Sparta are the 12 turn per year campaign, with much more brutal seasonal conditions. There isn't much of a difference between spring, summer, and autumn. Your agriculture will fluctuate, but winter sees an 80% decline in wealth, which cripples your economy. If unprepared, you will have a lot of desertion if you go bankrupt and can't pay your troops, so it's always good to have money in the bank just before winter. There is no attrition from fighting in winter, but it would have been nice to see a diplomatic penalty from raiding or attacking during winter, as historically it was frowned upon and it rarely happened as summer was the time for war. Something else that changes with the seasons is the rotational Pan-Hellenic Games, which replaces the dilemma system in the game to offer you the four same dilemmas each year, where different games are held and you can either ignore, send an envoy, back a competitor, or back the event, I think. Each gives you a chance of public order benefits and if your competitors win, and sometimes it yields a new general if they really performed well. It's a nice touch, though it's just an easy reward for you when you already become too big to be challenged, really. Culture has been done away with, instead being replaced by Hellenic tribalism, which is basically a fixed culture for each province, though capturing them won't actually cause any unrest apart from a small cultural difference debuff in Persia or up very north. Instead, it is supposed to cause conflict between true Greeks and those that aren't considered true Greek. Not really too sure about how that worked, because in my campaign, all of the Greek factions had cultural affinity with me when I was at war with them or not. Only Persia had aversion. So yeah, it might sound a bit harsh, but honestly, this didn't seem like a feature. They just removed culture and used the space to tell us what areas were Dorian, Ionian, and so on. Which is a nice touch from a historic point of view, but basically, you're just removing a critical piece of gameplay. Furthermore, dignitaries still rank up to be culture dominant and still have options to spread cultural tension, though it has zero effect, which just comes across as laziness, and makes them vastly underpowered compared to champions and spies. Something that was actually very cool was clicking on a region for the first time in the campaign gives you a nice paragraph about the history of the area and the mythology surrounding it. This was an awesome feature, and it's there for every single region in the game, 78 in total, and it's one I'd like to see in all Total War games. However, it would be better if it wasn't just a pop-up, but instead it was in some sort of description panel, and you could go back and read it when you have time, because sometimes you can end up missing it when you're skipping around different towns. The placement of nations seems to also be quite correct, though not many of them would field armies as they do in the game, and also the Athenian long walls down to the port are on the map, which is a very nice touch, making this one of the more historic campaigns in Total War ever. That's pretty much all the new features out of the way, I'm just going to give my thoughts on how the battles actually play out. Obviously, without shock cavalry, missile cavalry, artillery, or sword infantry, battles are extremely simplified. This also might just be me, but with the extreme focus on the map on the Aegean, it seems the terrain generation algorithm gives you a lot of planes, so the land is really even and battle maps become like quite boring and samey. I never fought down in the actual Peloponnese, which seems to be more hilly and mountainous, so perhaps there is more diversity down there, but up north, in the centre, and in Persia, it's quite a dull landscape. Battles themselves become quite repetitive after a few, mainly because the AI will generally create the same armies because of the limited number of units, and the fact that all factions share the same roster. What ends up happening is a reoccurrence of formations and tactics on the AI's part, with one strange formation I noticed where the AI bunched up tight and attacked me in the center, allowing me for to easily flank them and defeat them. This happened numerous times and it really became like immersion breaking. Siege warfare also becomes arduous after a time because we are dealing with spear units a lot. The best option is to turn off formation attack, as that will allow your troops to push on the walls a bit more, rather than having defensive stalemates that last 10 minutes each. I do have footage of an epic siege I had where Athens tried to land ships behind me. It was a really fun battle where I dealt with the navy first and then moved against the walls, but due to what I think is a pathfinding bug on the wall, my tick rate grinded to a halt and I had to wait about 30 minutes before it got out of its loop and resumed normal pace. This only seems to happen on certain maps, but it's definitely a pathfinding issue, as once my guys were all off the walls, the tick rate went back to normal. This isn't a Wrath of Sparta issue, but a Rome 2-1. So yeah, the battles are okay. They do just become repetitive over time, but you can still have some epic fights if you try to go against the odds, maybe bringing in a more experienced army against a larger inexperienced one. Another interesting bug I have with this DLC is nobody is wearing anything on their feet, be it my soldiers or theirs, even on the campaign map. So yeah, that's definitely a weird one. Not sure if this is in the game normally, but after I fought a very tough battle with one of my top generals, he was named a Hero of the Army, which is really cool to see. A little event message popped up and everything. It might just be the same thing as a triumph for if you're playing as Rome, but I just don't really play Greek that often, so I might not have seen it, but that was something that I noticed in this, and that was really cool. Lastly, I'll talk about my experience with the campaign. Basically, my campaign was on very hard as Corinth, and I've lasted it to a whopping 170 turns. Basically, the thing that has hampered my progress so greatly since turn 100 is the agents. I'm not going to finish this campaign, ever probably, and I don't care anymore because it's become too frustrating. Every time I make an awesome army, move it out of town, I will get instantly halted, poisoned, killed, or ambushed because of agents. I always have a 10-star agent in the army for protection, I have about 10 agents myself because of manipulation, and still, I just get grinded to a halt and killed off because I can't reach their towns. I've actually relied heavily on navies to capture most places as they aren't affected by agents. 12 turns per year, with so many factions, causes so many problems. Taking out factions is such a relief to see like 5 10-star agents die with that faction. I honestly don't know why CA don't limit agents so that they can collectively only attempt an attack on one target per turn for these longer campaigns where agents will never die of old age, or why manipulation allows you to field more agents than your Imperium even allows. Anyway, for that reason alone, I won't be finishing this campaign as agents have sucked all the fun out of it, and I actually can't get a battle. Like literally, I've had 3 armies try to get to Athens from Corinth, which is just 2 turns away, and they can't make it. Anyway guys, that's my experience and review of this DLC. The combat has been simplified, making it more dull, and battles last far too long, especially down streets or on walls where you cannot flank. The campaign endgame is wrecked because of agent spam. Persia are more of an annoyance than a real threat because their troop quality is so bad, and there is a chance that the Ionian League will just beat them out anyway. Naval battles are what they have always been, so I just auto-resolve them. Culture has been removed, so province management is really easy. The new tech tree is cool to look at, but has some weird techs, like for instance, battle rhythm allows me to build a trading port and a fish market, and for some reason, it's in the military chain. The new units aren't all that new. Picked hoplites, archers, slingers, javelin men, militia hoplites, and more are all in the game already. The different factions all act and feel the same with the same rosters, and Sparta has giant walls for some reason. Anyway folks, I don't score my reviews, but rather let you make your own mind up. The redeeming qualities of this DLC are that it's more historic than any other campaign so far, but that is partially what makes it fall down in terms of gameplay. If they fix the agent spam and were to introduce a bit more variety, then it would be a lot better. I'm sure in the meantime, modders will be hard at work to do just that. That's all for me, and I'll see you in the next one.
Immortals, we'll put their name to the test.